So in addressing Tier 1 best practices, we'll focus on the four recommendations from the IES Practice Guide, Teaching Academic Content and Literacy to English Learners in Elementary and Middle School, which Lindsey introduced a bit earlier. The guide recommends four practices for vocabulary instruction. First, choose a brief, engaging piece of informational text that includes academic vocabulary as a platform for intensive academic vocabulary instruction. Second, choose a small set of academic vocabulary for in-depth instruction. Third, teach academic vocabulary in depth using multiple modalities, so that is to say writing, speaking, listening, and reading. And teach word learning strategies to help students independently figure out the meaning of words. Sorry about that, folks. Let's think about how these practices would work for Isabel and Adnan. Isabel, who speaks Spanish at home, might benefit from reviewing cognate words, which are similar in English and Spanish. And it might be helpful for Adnan, who has struggled with reading and writing in English, to keep a personal dictionary in which you help him locate images that represent words, as well as synonyms, and sample sentences for new vocabulary words. One way to expand on vocabulary instruction is through creating word maps, which include information comparable to a dictionary, except using concept bubbles. The guide recommends four practices for integrating oral and written English language instruction into content area teaching. First, strategically use instructional tools, such as short videos, visuals, and graphic organizers, to anchor instruction and help students make sense of content. Second, explicitly teach the content-specific academic vocabulary, as well as the general academic vocabulary that supports it, during content area instruction. Third, provide daily opportunities for students to talk about content in pairs or small groups. Fourth, provide writing opportunities to extend student learning and understanding of the content material. Let's think about how these practices would work for Isabel and Adnan. Isabel might benefit from generating interaction with schemata and text, or GIST. GIST is an activity in which teachers invite students to read a short text and highlight academic or other vocabulary while reading. After reading, they exchange summaries of the content of the passage in a small group or with a partner orally. Next, the small group works together to rewrite the passage in a way that maintains meaning and the key vocabulary, but might be in more accessible language. For Adnan, who arrived recently and has lower English proficiency, you might consider integrating sentence starters for him during an activity like GIST. So he can practice oral English and use them to scaffold his writing. The guide recommends four practices for writing instruction. Provide writing assignments that are anchored in content and focused on developing academic language as well as writing skills. For all writing assignments, provide language-based supports that facilitate students' entry into and continued development of writing. Use small groups or pairs to provide opportunities for students to work and talk together on varied aspects of writing. And finally, assess students' writing periodically to identify instructional needs and provide positive, constructive feedback in response. Let's think about how these practices would work for Isabel and Adnan. You might provide alternative opportunities for both Isabel and Adnan to develop their writing in stages. For example, they might start by using graphic organizers that are tailored to their language proficiency levels to organize their thoughts. Adnan, therefore, might draw what he plans to write. Once the graphic organizers are complete, they could be provided with example sentences for integrating into their planned writing. After writing, you might ask Isabel and Adnan to work with a peer who might review the writing and together identify areas where sentences could be even more descriptive or detailed based on vocabulary words you have provided for them in advance. In an activity like this, it's critical that the writing is anchored by core content learning. The guide recommends 5 practices for small group instructional interventions. Use available assessment information to identify students who demonstrate persistent struggles with aspects of language and literacy development. Design the content of small group instruction to target students' identified needs. Provide additional instruction in small groups consisting of 3 to 5 students to those struggling with language and literacy. For students who struggle with basic foundational reading skills, spend time not only on these skills, but also on vocabulary development and listening and reading comprehension strategies. Provide scaffolded instruction that includes frequent opportunities for students to practice and review newly learned skills and concepts in various contexts over several lessons to ensure retention. Let's think about how these practices would work for Isabel and Adnan. For Isabel, you might choose to group her with other native Spanish speakers and invite them to speak and write in their native language. For Adnan, before grouping, be sure to account for his experience as a refugee and allow him to listen to others without pressure to participate in the beginning. He may be invited to participate by selecting cards that represent content from a story, feelings, numbers, or other types of information. In this way, he can share his answers despite his English proficiency level. To summarize, the best practices for Tier 1. Focus on vocabulary in depth over meaningful amounts of time. Ensure you're accounting for all 4 language domains. Provide writing opportunities that are well-structured and scaffolded consistently and regularly. For students struggling with literacy or English development, conduct small-scale interventions in smaller groups.